Good afternoon and welcome to today's webinar. Thank you for standing by. All participants are in listen-only mode. As a reminder, this event is being recorded and will be archived on pumpsandsystems.com. I'm Jennifer King, editor of Pumps and Systems Media. Today's topic, Between Bearing Pumps, Bearing the Weight of Failure, will be presented by Sulzer. The presentation today will be about 45 minutes long, followed by 15 minutes for Q&A. Please feel free to enter questions in the Q&A or chat feature throughout the presentation, and our speakers will answer the questions at the end. And now I will turn it over to Doug Story to introduce our speakers. Thank you, Doug.
Well, thank you, Jennifer. Well, I'd like to welcome everybody to our latest webinar. I'd like to thank Pumps and Systems for setting this up to us and honored to have with me today a very talented team of Sulzer experts. Today's webinar will consist of two main topics. The first is a dive into modern analysis of old style bearing assemblies. And the second is re-engineering for reliability. So we'll do some quick introductions here. My name is Doug Story. I've been with Sulzer for a little over 4 years now. Most of my background is in pumps, mechanical seals, and turbo machinery. I started out as an applications engineer in pumps, went on to be a sales engineer role, and have now focused as a reliability type specialist in the retrofit role. And we'll hand it on to the rest of the team.
Hi, I'm Ryan Hack. I've been with Sulzer in product development now for about 10 years. I've got a total of 20 years in the pumping industry altogether. And most of that time has been focused on bearing design and bearing assemblies and bearing cooling.
My name is Landon Cooper. I've also been with Sulzer for about 10 years now as a field engineer within the RES group. So our group provides feedback from the field to Ryan's group to aid in the design improvements for future projects and things, and as well as just working with the customers to give their pumps new life.
Hey, the last and the least today, I'm Seth Tate. I work with Doug Story in the retrofit group. I'm super honored to work with some great engineers and working for such a great company. My hope today is that you, the audience, get a chance to learn a thing or two. And as well, I hope that you go and fix something in a way that it never becomes a problem for you again.
All right. Well, thank you, team. So in addition to this webinar, I'd like to point everybody out to several of the case studies and white papers the Sulzer team has written here recently. We'll put links in the chat to these for some future reading. And some of these can be found right here on the Pumps and Systems platform. So now we'll do a dive into the modern analysis of old bearing assemblies. And we'll let Ryan take these slides away.
Thanks, Doug. So I want to start off first by just highlighting three points here that have in API 610 that have changed over the additions related to bearings and bearing requirements. The first being this rotational speed limitation. If you go back into the early 80s, there was no mention of this speed factor at all. You see the speed factor there in the blue box, rotational speed times the mean diameter of the bearing. And these are for roller bearings specifically. Then as we come through the various editions of API, seventh edition, it was introduced, but it was ultra conservative. Eighth edition, it started to be less conservative and similar to the current language. Then you see there at the bottom, the 12th edition is what the current language is. So the limits right now are 500,000 for oil lubricated bearings and 350,000 for grease. Now there's a caveat there that further reduction is possible due to temperature or other factors that are happening.
Ryan, I'm just curious here. This is something that we've talked about before, but rotational speed limitations, we have that and the API says that for what reason? And what are we using that for?
Well, I think like many things in API, it's to help safeguard end users that they have a reliable piece of equipment. If you're spinning your bearing faster than, you know, some limits produced by specifically by bearing manufacturers themselves, like SKF, they have reference speeds for all their bearings. So if you're starting to approach those type of numbers, then your machine is going to be less reliable. So I think, you know, the API is basically just kind of piggybacking on that type of a theory to safeguard end users.
I know in my background, we don't use this equation to make any decisions off of in my entire career almost. My assumption then is like, this is something that goes into the design of the equipment and, you know, to Landon as well. Are we using this kind of equation and these limitations and stuff like that when we're making choices? Are we actually, the Sulzer and companies like us have some kind of a specification that we follow that's similar, but more constrained or less constrained?
Yeah, we use this type of equation to make judgments on what size bearing housing is best suited for a given pump range or pump model. And we've kind of predetermined that, so you on your end won't see it. It's, you know, already in our product catalog that we've sized the bearing to the pump, and then we can make small adjustments on that as needed, you know, based on extreme conditions or what have you.
Yeah, gotcha.
All right, we'll move on to the next one here.
So this next one is energy density. This has been, again, you know, in the sixth edition, no mention of it. Energy density is power times RPM. And then in the seventh edition, they came out with some figures that were what we'll call ultra conservative. And then as we move through it, they get less conservative to the point where we're at now in the 12th edition. And I'll highlight some of those values over here on the left-hand side. Now in the 12th edition, they've also done something. They've split, drawn a line in the sand between pipeline pumps and non-pipeline pumps. And I'll talk about that in just a minute here. So what this is, you see these figures here, 5.4 million horsepower RPM. Just so you're aware, that would roughly be 1,500 horsepower at 3,600 RPM, just to give you an idea. So anything below that, you can use roller bearings, roller radial, roller thrust. And then if you're above that in non-pipeline, then API recommends going to a hydrodynamic bearing for the radial bearing. So you'd have a sleeve radial and a roller thrust. And then if you're, for non-pipeline, you're still in that same realm. So sleeve radial, roller thrust would be in the same realm as the roller for both. And then if you're above that, then they recommend going to hydrodynamic for both. Now pipeline's different. Pipeline you see between 5.4 and 10.7 million, you can use a sleeve ball arrangement. And greater than 10.7, they recommend going to hydrodynamic for both.
So Ryan.
Yeah, go ahead, Doug.
So Ryan, I'll jump in here. I think it's really interesting that API was extremely conservative in some of the previous versions, and it seems they're really pushing the boundary. What's caused that? You know, is this a comfort in the design? What are your thoughts there?
I think it's a couple things. It's based on years and years of experience in the field. API is made up of a whole bunch of pump companies and pump engineers, and they, you know, over the years know that Sulzer and others have been kind of pushing the limits on what the previous limits were. So that's part of it, and part of the reason why we're allowed to do that, or that we've been doing that, is because of our often a lot of our modern techniques for analyzing, you know, doing thermal analysis and that sort of thing, and optimizing bearing housings through advanced sort of techniques that we weren't able to do, say, in the early 80s, mid 80s, and even into the 90s.
You know, something I'd point out to the audience here, what in the previous slide and this slide, and what you'll see throughout this whole presentation, somewhere in 1996, a lot of things changed. So we'll kind of talk about that as we go through it, but it's this eighth edition weird shift specific. Do we see this conservative number? These become very close to what we see today. You know, Ryan, we have talked about this once before. You said something to the effect of, you know, you have this 10.7, anything 10.7, you got to be sleeve radial, tilt pad thruster, you know, hydrodynamic bearings across the board. But we talked about, you know, companies like ourselves, we've actually pushed beyond those boundaries in some of these applications.
Sure.
What gives us the confidence in doing so, and why do we do it?
Well, we do it specifically, we do it a lot in pipeline, I would say, because, pipeline customers typically don't want extra systems, you know. So when you have a tilt pad thrust bearing, you know, you have to have an oil lube system, and they don't want that. They don't, that's extra equipment to maintain out in the field, out often in the middle of nowhere. And it's one more system to break down and have to keep going. Not to mention the cost, when you get into that tilt pad thrust type of arrangement, the initial upfront cost goes way up as well. So those are two reasons why the customer and the end user doesn't want it. And so what we do and other companies do is, you know, you perform, risk mitigation the best you can, and you get as much cooling built into your sleeve ball arrangement as you can. And then you test the heck out of it, or as much as you can anyway. And then over the years, you've pushed the boundary a little bit, and then you push it a little bit more and a little bit more, and then you become more comfortable knowing what's out there in the field already working.
So experience comes into play then. Yeah. with the choices we make and things of that nature. And that leads me to that question, Landon. Landon, you're on the different side. You know, Ryan, you're on the R&D side and designing our bearings and continue to make those incrementally better improvements. Landon, you're on the other side of it, taking older equipment and bringing them closer to API 610's current edition code, things like that, and putting these kind of bearing systems on there, upgrading bearing systems to this stuff. When you're doing that, do we take this stuff into account?
Typically, once a pump's been in the field, we may not necessarily look at these equations, because we're just going to look at history of the pump and, I guess, evaluate whether or not we need to apply some of these newer technology, I guess, to help with bringing down cooling and or increase the longevity of the pump's bearings.
Okay.
All right. Well, you mentioned longevity of the bearings there. I think that leads us onto the next slide quite well.
Yeah, so L10 bearing life, won't get into a whole lot here other than just to point out that there was a step change when we got to the 11th edition in the way that L10 life is being calculated per API 610. So 10th edition and older, you see that was kind of the weakest link approach, where if your thrust bearing was 25,000 hours and your radial bearing was 25, then you reported that as being 25. Whereas now in the 11th and 12th edition, we're asked to be a little more stringent in how we report bearing life. So you see this equation down here on the lower left, and you individually calculate each bearing's L10 life like you did before, but then you put that into this system life equation. And basically what that means is now 25,000 plus 25,000 only yields 15,000. So if you work backward and you want to get 25,000, then you're looking at something approximately 40,000 hours for each bearing individually. So that's, it's much more stringent for pump companies, but it's ultimately, you know, gives a lot better, more robust bearing assembly to customers and end users.
So everything built to 11th edition, 12th edition then has a more robust bearing assembly as long as it's following API 610 practices. And then back, you know, Landon, as we do this, we replace our these old bearing housings with new bearing housings. Automatically, they're going from that old calculation approach to what we use in our newer designs today, right?
Yeah, so if we are looking at doing a retrofit for an older pump, bringing it to the new standards of bearing housings, we will take a look at these calculations to ensure that we're putting the right size bearing on that new pump or yeah. old pump. Yeah.
I mean that doesn't mean the bearings is the natural cause of your problems while you're doing the upgrade. I mean, you gotta connect all these pieces together. We understand that, and we go through that process as well. But you're clearly getting a shift in the robust values, I guess, coming from the bearings themselves when you're doing these roller bearing calculations.
All right, we'll go ahead and move on to the next one here.
So this one, just want to point out some of the lessons learned over the years, things that, you know, have changed and are maybe not necessarily requirements per API 610, but things that ourselves and other pump companies have kind of learned and implemented over the years. So you see on the left-hand side there, this is a very old pump. You can see it's a kind of a packing gland design there. So that gives you an indication on how old it is. Some things to point out, you know, it doesn't have an outboard fan. The bearings are more of a submerged type rather than a splash lubricated type. It's got a very small oil sump, which limits your ability to, you know, provide heat transfer through the oil. You can see, again, related to heat transfer, there's no cooling fins on the outside of the housing. And of course, without a fan, you know, even if it had fins, you wouldn't be taking the full benefit there. And then on the right-hand side, you see, you know, these incremental changes that we've implemented over the years. And we've got a large outboard fan. We've got a large oil sump. We've got cooling fins on the housing, maximizing our heat transfer there. We've got an inboard fan, and this acts as a heat sink, you know, to remove heat that's coming down the shaft toward the bearing from your process fluid. The mechanical seal will also take heat out of that shaft as well, but then this inboard fan is just one more provision to help do that.
Yeah, and something just to add on too, we've taken some of our older design pumps where it doesn't have all these fans and kind of put a new bearing housing on. We've had a pump that was in a hot service. They're getting deflection. They're in the warm-up process, and we found by and their bearings were running a little on the hot side too. So we found by adding the fans, updating it to isolators, and we also made it a 360 degree bearing housing drip pocket as well. We found that it helped lower the overall temperature and also help with the alignment of the pump as well, so we weren't getting that deflection, and it brought a lot longer life to the pump and bearings as well.
And I think just to real quick that, you know, if we don't hear about something, then that's good news to us. We never know that it works really well. A lot of times we just never hear from the company that made the shift.
Yeah, so you mentioned the deflection there, Landon. This kind of ties into what you're talking about. This isn't anyway an API requirement or upgrade, but ourselves and others have designs in both 180 and 360 bearing housings now, and that's pretty standard, kind of standard state of the art now, you might say. The 360, as you can see just by the cross section and by looking at the isometric view here, is just going to be a much stiffer type of mounted bearing arrangement and less chance for for deflection to kind of take over in the shaft. And then ultimately, you know, deflection leads to shorter seal life in the long run. So once again, we'll kind of pick on this same old style housing here. You can see there's, you know, outside of a plug that's maybe used for, I don't know, a sight glass or something, there's really no drillings in this to speak of at all. So there's no ability to put any type of instrumentation monitoring in it. On the right-hand side, you can see this is our current sort of state of the art where, I mean, we can instrument it, you know, basically however you like. We can get oil sump temperature, we can get bearing race temperature, we can get sleeve journal metal temperature, vibration, XY probes, et cetera. So very instrument friendly. We can go to the next one there, Doug. Yeah.
Yeah.
So here now you can see some of the things that we gain by putting this instrumentation on a bearing housing. This is just a couple of plots taken from XY probes that we had on a sleeve journal. And you can tell very quickly when you have a good behavior or a bad behavior as far as the rotor and the rotor position, which ultimately impacts, you know, how it's going to, what kind of life you're going to get out of your bearing. So on the left one here, upper left, you see this is a good behaving rotor running pretty much right in the middle. Just to the right of that, you see a bad behavior here where it's changing all over the map, kind of, well, not all over the map, but mostly to the one side there, changing with flow. So as you increase flow, the rotor shifts to one side and then it shifts back at various flow points. So if you have rotor instability like that, you're ultimately gonna, you know, it's gonna lead ultimately to a bearing failure, a bearing wipe, as you see on the image there on the right-hand side. Now this one is one that we caught early on our test bed. So that's why we have this image here. And this sort of instrumentation and telemetry can quickly point out if you don't already know due to some other indicator like bearing temperature or something, you can see very quickly that, oh, this is a problem. We might want to shut it down and see if we have some issue with alignment or something else. The two images here on the bottom, these are coast down plots. So you can see a good behavior there again on the left-hand side where it, from the time where you hit the power off, the shaft just kind of comes more or less straight down to a resting point. And the one on the right is what we would call a bad behavior. And you know, it's starting out here on the left. And then as you coast down, it's shifting all the way over to the right. So that's bad because now you're potentially not only wiping one side of the bearing, but you know, maybe even the other side as it coasts down as well. So one way that we can potentially, when we see these sort of things, you know, I mentioned alignment checks, but another thing that we might do on our own test bed or could also be done in the field as well, if you're having recurring issues with this sort of thing is go to a different type of bearing. On the left here, you see what we would call a standard cylindrical bearing. It's got two oil lobes there at 3 and 9. And you can see it's a real round, just a cylindrical bore bearing. On the right is what we call a lemon bearing. And this one's exaggerated. They're not normally visually perceptible that it is a lemon bearing, but the way a lemon bearing is made, basically you would put a shim between the two bearing halves and then you would rebore it. And then when you take the shim out and you put the bearing shell back together, then you have a tighter clearance at the 6 and 12 o'clock position than you do on the sides there. And what this can do is it can improve the bearing stability in that there's not as much free space, let's say, for the oil that's not supporting the shaft at the bottom dead center there, the oil and the rest of the cavity in a cylindrical bearing. If you have one of these bad behaviors that's where the rotor's shifting around, then the oil also is shifting around and the oil can start to whirl around, and that can ultimately impact your rotor stability as well. And so in the journal, in the lemon journal bearing, we can tend to limit some of that sort of reaction.
But when it comes to these kind of specific design changes, we don't apply this across the board. This is as we investigate some bearing issue. This is when we start to look at what are the options, what are the causes and remediations, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, we don't use a lemon bearing as a standard. We use this like it shows here, the just regular cylindrical bearing as our standard, and then the lemon bearing would be, you know, a possible fix for some of these behavioral issues that we see from time to time.
Yeah. Okay.
Some of those issues could be, you know, like I mentioned, alignment. Another issue could be casting deviation from one pump to another. You know, sometimes you'll see sister pumps and one's behaving, you know, one's running nice and cool and the other one is not. And, you know, what's the difference? Well, you know, these great big heavy castings on these pump cases, you know, they're not as repeatable as everyone would like to think they are. And small deviations in the hydraulic passageways can really impact how the rotor behaves due to radial forces. One more thing I'd like to point out here as another thing that's non-standard, but that non-standard for normal sort of temperature applications, but it is standard in very high process fluid temps. We can do these milled slots in the bearing bracket hanger, and that reduces the heat soak from the process fluid that's heating up your pump case or your cover if it's an end cover design, and that limits the amount of heat that's transferred into the bearing housing and can in some cases reduce the oil temp and the bearing temp, you know, quite drastically, as we show here, 10 to 30 degrees F in some cases.
Cool. And just another thing to point out too, there's a coating on that face too that kind of acts as a thermal barrier to prevent the heat transferring into the bearing housing as well.
Oh yeah, I did notice there's a color difference. I never really inspected in my head why that was there. Okay.
So this could be one of those examples where we actually go to the 360 housing to minimize the deflection even more, right?
Yeah, the kind of two different topics in a way there. The heat soak, you know, in a 360 would still be, you'd still be fighting that as well, and probably even more so because your surface area is greater in a 360 housing. So, you know, everything's kind of a juggling act. What works in one case isn't always going to solve all your problems in another case.
Sure.
Absolutely. All right, we'll go ahead and move on here. We're going to skip over this slide for the sake of time. This is just some quick cause and effects you can go through and look at you know, later date when this presentation goes out. So now we'll do a few slides on what we call the consequences on the do-nothing case. This is the case where I leave my old addition housings alone, and some of the things that I might not realize are happening with this pump and not taking advantage of the new technology. So one of the ones we'll look at here is we were kind of going over the new design that's air-cooled with the new fins. Well, in many cases, we can eliminate this cooling water. We can go much, much hotter without having to cooling water these bearing housings. And you can see we kind of did a little bit of math here just showing, hey, maybe there's a little cost savings in the actual water aspect and utility resources we can save by eliminating those cooling water jackets.
Yeah, so, you know, we went through these numbers. When I did them first, they were much higher. I was pretty excited, and then we kind of thought, that just seems weird. Kind of the numbers that you see here. I mean, you're talking about $52 in savings a year. It's not something you go to your plant manager with and say, okay, I got something with an obvious return on investment specific to the money aspect. Now you throw this across all the bearing housings that you could do this to, because there's a lot of change from older equipment to now, and you can do a lot with cooling fans and bigger sumps and stuff that we have in today's designs and get rid of cooling water. So it's a lot of them. And so there is a number associated with that. But really, I think the big key kicker and everything is there's a lot of equipment at a facility that needs to stay cool from cooling water, using cooling water. So I think it's pretty safe to say most of us can think of something or many pieces of equipment that struggles to stay cool. So being able to reduce that heat injection into your system, as well as improve the heat or the flow rates through other pieces, because you're not running it through these bearing housings, you know, what other equipment does struggles? What, you know, your seals, a lot of times these bearings are cooled. The seals are cooled. The seal support systems are cooled. You know, there's a lot of cooling going on, giving those seals that cooler water instead, on and on. You kind of look at that perspective. It can be very powerful in a remediation desire and remediation change. So
yeah, that's a great point, Seth. And then the other aspect too, this is a way to eliminate a moving part, a possible failure mode. I mean, how many times have we seen these old cast in water jackets fail? And a lot of times those are in cast iron housings where, hey, maybe that's a little harder fix. So this just brings an extra failure point outside, and, you know, just minimizes the chance of failure. All right, we'll go on to our next kind of implement consequences for the do-nothing case. So let's look at what happens to our mechanical seals.
So I want to just point out in this slide here, you know, mechanical seals are at a different level than pumps. And I always think about how those faces have to track each other. You know, they're trying to keep a gap between the faces of like 20 millionths to 40 millionths of an inch to be considered a little to no leaking seal, right? And they're going to have to track each other with all the vibrations and misalignments and things of that nature. So when it comes to mechanical seals, you know, the consequence of the do-nothing case is just vibration is always, the higher the vibration is always going to have consequences to the life of the mechanical seal, as well as the stiffness of the system. And one thing that changes when you, it's been changing over the years, is the desire to go from packing to mechanical seals. And when we do that, a lot of times those old pumps were designed with that packing as what creates stiffness for the rotor. A big consequence when you go switch that out and you have a low life mechanical seal. So the difference between these old designs and new designs, you kind of see in that picture, the older ones had the ability to be longer, hold a skinnier shaft over a longer distance. While now what we do is compact it together as much as possible to give this much stiffness, both in the shaft and rotor, as well as in the structure of the housing itself.
Yeah, I think this one's especially interesting on the packing situation. And you think by going to the mechanical seal design, well, that's an improvement. I'm improving my pump. You know, I'm bringing it to the modern era. But you don't realize that, you know, you really got to kind of take a holistic approach to this pump and make sure you're not altering something that you didn't even intend for. All right, so now we'll get into our next section here, and this is the re-engineering for reliability. So we've kind of alluded to this idea throughout the presentation here, but it's this need to take a step change in my fleet's reliability, in that we could actually use current bearing assembly technology on our older style pumps and use one solution for all type of approach. I kind of see this as a proactive way to eliminate those many failure modes we've been talking about and kind of take care of them in one fail swoop.
So Landon, Doug and I, we work at the customer level. We go on site, we're investigating issues, things like that. A lot of times we come to you and your team with these, hey, this is an opportunity to really look at, you know, instead of spending hours and hours doing RCA analysis, can we look at can we fit our bearing housing on here and eliminate all these different failure modes, including the one we think it is? I mean, how often do you guys get this as an option, I guess, or look at it as an option?
It's actually, I would say like once every few months, we probably get a question on that in regards to bearings and how to improve the bearing life in a pump. And, you know, typically if depending on the age of the bearings and, you know, what the problem is kind of determines whether or not we may want to replace it entirely, or perhaps we just want to modernize the bearings by, you know, maybe we can put a fan on the inboard of the shaft to help out, or change out the deflectors, so isolators, or change the oil ring, or even just look at the journal bearing to see if we can change the L over D. Or maybe we just need to change it, as we talked about in the last slide, to a lemon bore bearing to help help it be more stable. So it's a constant question, but probably the biggest thing we always look at when we get a bearing question with high temperatures is we always look at the thrust, just because design changes and how they're operating over the years changes. And that seems to be the biggest thing that leads to a high temperature in the bearings is just a high thrust load.
Yeah.
And another thing I've seen several times, or, you know, working with the end users, a lot of times you have these sixth edition pumps, or, you know, older edition API pumps. And the first thought is, well, at this point, I'm gonna need a new pump. But the idea here is you can just replace the assemblies and bring that pump largely to a current edition and bring a whole step change in its reliability. And then you don't have all the extra costs that, you know, kind of get forgotten about at times during a new project. You know, these are changes to the foundations, changes to the piping, changes to the infrastructure of the pump that you wouldn't have to worry about by just modernizing the pump in the field already.
Yeah, so we certainly talk about that a lot.
Absolutely. So it kind of brings up the question, you know, should I replace my bearing houses? And, you know, kind of like most things in our industry, a nice big gray area, I would say the answer is maybe. And we'll kind of go into that. So we've kind of touched on, you know, that 1996 date, the eighth edition. These are really the kind of the pumps we're targeting by more of the proactive bearing changeout, bearing assembly changeout initiatives, because that's where they're really, you know, the biggest impacts to these designs. So a real big one here, the older editions API actually allowed for the use of cast iron and ductile iron housings. I gotta imagine on our aftermarket end, we've seen the effects of these quite a bit in our repair shops. You know, whether, you know, braze welding or having to sleeve these bores, there's definitely better ways to repair these. And a lot of times you're putting more money into the repair of these aspects than doing a more proactive approach and actually just replacing the housing.
Yeah, it's from our perspective, you know, we're the one making suggestions that have cost implications you have to make a decision on, right? We keep coming to this point. If it's a cast iron housing, replace it. Stop worrying about repairing that thing. Every time we come to the conclusion of, okay, we got to do all this braze work, we hit two points. One, all that money we just spent trying to braze it, or we're about to spend to braze and everything, you could have just replaced the whole bearing housing with a modern design, like you see in the picture. And two, the risks of success are there. And we try to express that to you as well. You know, the work we do is the best work you can get, but you're talking about brazing a cast iron housing. It may not be as reliable as you would hope it would be. There's risks to the workmanship, just specifically because you're brazing, not welding, things like that.
Well, and it kind of seems a little bit more of a band-aid approach than attacking the core of the problem. A lot of times it comes up the aspect of, well, I've got a very short outage window. How do we manage that? Well, the great thing with these new housing designs is you can order them ahead of time, and the casting items and the long lead items you can have ahead of pulling the pump. And then we can do a very quick upgrade during the outage window. And then a lot of times actually be quicker than, you know, some of these, you know, kind of band-aid fixes.
Yeah, so the point of the slide, it has this little section, we're not going to go over it, but you'll notice the section in the middle of the next few slides that we're just trying to help give you guys the best methods. We've done it a million different ways, and we will continue to do it a million different ways. If you follow those steps there, right there, it is the most successful way of doing it with the least risk in doing it, and makes it just easy for you to, it's your easy button, easy for you to do it as best possible, we think, and let you, you know, focus more on the important things, I think, than delivering outage.
Absolutely. So we've kind of already touched on this one, but, you know, anytime you have those water-cooled, water-jacketed housings, you know, this is a real easy step change to bring them to the modern design with the air-finned housings. You know, definitely something to think about, you know, when you're working an older pump that's requiring that water still.
Yeah, in the picture you're seeing there, that's right after repair.
Yeah. Yeah, there's cast iron. I mean, the material's brittle, so it's much tougher to work with. You know, they tend to break, and you know, we've probably seen during these freeze a lot of those broke too.
Yeah, and that's the water jacket that's busted through both on the inside and out to the atmosphere.
So the next idea on this is the spare parts inventory costs. And, you know, it's kind of odd. We're talking about reliability. You know, why are we bringing spare parts cost in here? But these consolidated new bearing assemblies can actually be put on many different OEMs and many different pumps and all sorts of different models. You can basically standardize your fleet with a single set of housings and then end up reducing the amount of parts you've stocked because they're common amongst the entire fleet.
It's a big difference, and not just the commonality, but you're also going to have your obsolete, hard to get versus on the shelf. So timing as well is involved.
Yeah, that's a fantastic point. Availability is key these days. We've kind of already touched on this one, but this is you know, when we know we're just having bearing issues over and over, mechanical steel issues, it might be time to just take this step change approach instead.
So within this thing, what we're really showing in that particular picture or in this slide is still, we're talking the pre-1996 stuff, the stuff before computers were invented and you being used as a computational analysis and designing oil and gas bearings, right? So anything pre-1996, pre-8th edition, don't fix it if it ain't broke, right? But if you're having low mechanical seal life, low bearing life, so if it's less than 10-year bearing life, seal life, things that like of that nature, this is where it's worth, you know, plausibly replacing it. If you have low life and you have these old pumps, put this in your repertoire of upgrade options. Just a full bearing assembly replacement.
We'll go, we'll kind of skip over this one because we already touched on this, but you know, just to think that, you know, that packing was actually acting as a stabilization, almost bushing back in these older designs. So something to look at, you know, for the newer designs as well. So now we're going to kind of go back to that, you know, that step change, the 8th edition. So here we're going to look at the pumps that were designed after 1996, when we've really kind of taken advantage of current technology. These are more the one-off approach. This is when you get to put your detective hat on and kind of figure out, you know, what are the small step changes I need to make in this particular pump? This is when some of those advanced concepts like the lemon bore bearings and, you know, the slots in the housing kind of, you know, come into play.
Yeah, so post 1996 designs are very close to what we do. There's some incremental changes over the years. Persons like Ryan are making these changes and improvements, and we're talking percents instead of 50% improvement in something. It's a few percent improvement, and we're going to continue to do that. But in this case, instead of a complete bearing housing replacement, anything newer, we generally recommend, let's actually go through a full investigation. Let's see what the root causes are and try to remediate those. And that's really this slide and the next slide. It's kind of the same stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So we'll kind of wrap it up here and kind of go over the summary. The high points I want everybody to take away from today's talk is that, you know, pump designs based on many parameters we went over today. Speed factor, energy density, L10 life, but there's even more factors than that, you know, that we can go on in future presentations. API 610 has changed significantly over the additions. You know, let's leverage the new technology in our older style pumps. Leads right into the next one. Replacing the bearing assemblies can actually be more economical to than buying a new pump. And you got to factor in all the extra, you know, piping, foundation, electrical, all those other aspects that'll you know, make that new pump more difficult, more expensive than you know, just that price tag off the bat. The next one, chasing individual issues can actually be more time intensive and labor intensive than a proactive plan. You know, if you take that step change with these new housings, you're getting that much more, and you know, you're not putting quite the time and energy into it. Finally, the consolidated bearing assembly, it can be applied to all pump OEMs, all models, and you can end up with a single style of bearing housing for many different pumps. This helps your parts availability, and it helps reduce your inventory amounts and costs as well. So from here, we'd like to thank everybody for listening. There's been a lot discussed today. Hope everybody enjoyed it and learned a little bit. I know I have. If you have any further questions, my contact information as well as Seth's is there on the screen. Please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We're happy to answer any questions we can. From here, we'll, big thank you again to Pumps and Systems. It's been an outstanding platform. We appreciate the fact that they got us all out here to connect and give us this opportunity. So I'm going to hand it back to Jennifer, and she'll take it from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Yes, thank you guys so much for a great presentation. We really appreciate it. And we have quite a few questions. If we don't get to your question today, as Doug mentioned, please feel free to email Doug or Seth at those email addresses, and we'll try to get everybody's questions answered. So I'm going to go ahead and try to get a few of these. The first question that we had was in relation to API 610 is considered common for PL or non-PL applications. He asks, in other words, after what discharge length is considered a PL pump?
Discharge length. I think that's just a different concept than what we're talking about, pipeline versus not pipeline. We're talking industry change at completely different industry. So
yeah, I think
PL meaning. Go ahead, Brian. Yeah.
I think he's asking basically how long of piping is it before you consider it to be a quote pipeline pump. What we mean in pipeline pumps is, pumps that are piping crude or other product, across the country, not like across the parking lot. Across the parking lot would be non-pipeline, across the country would be pipeline.
Okay.
That's how we interpret API 610's statement of pipeline versus pipeline.
Yeah.
Okay. And when you are referring to roller bearings, is that specific to cylindrical or spherical roller? Or does this refer to any rolling element bearing?
Yeah, good question. It's any rolling element bearing. So your deep groove ball and your angular contact bearings, anything that's got a rolling element in it, as opposed to a sleeve journal bearing would be the other type.
Okay. Someone asked how to fit fan for drive end bearings.
So I assume you mean for if the pump wasn't originally designed for a fan. So there's really only two options. You can take your existing rotor and sort of scab on a stub shaft on the end of it and mount a fan to that, which would be like a big time band-aid to the arrangement. Or, your other option is to replace the rotor with a longer shaft that's designed for a fan.
Okay.
Yeah, just maybe it might be end up a completely different bearing housing like we've been talking about.
Exactly, yeah.
And what is the maximum temperature limit for MSD pumps?
I don't know either.
That's a little off topic.
Okay, I wondered if I was trying to relate to what we
were bearing guys. Okay. We can tell you about bearing temperature limits.
Okay.
we can get you that. If you want to email Seth or Doug, we can get you that.
Okay. I apologize.
We definitely can.
I wonder if that came in during talking about putting the fan cooled housings instead of the water cooled housings. Ryan, that's usually 600, 650, somewhere around that range. Isn't that correct?
As far as process temp?
Yes.
Again, off the top of my head, I'm not totally sure.
Okay. It's a much bigger number, and let's make sure we answer that to the crowd too in an email.
Thank you, everyone. Okay, and is there a minimum diameter that you have for elliptical bearings?
No, there's not any specific size limitation of them. I think the smallest that we do is somewhere about 2-inch or 50 millimeter, but there's nothing saying you couldn't go smaller.
Okay. And in what case is a lemon bearing used?
Well, I highlighted one in the presentation there where we might have a rotor that's operating in an unstable manner off to one side or the other. That would be the probably our most prevalent use case, but you know, there could be others. You know, there's nothing saying you couldn't use a lemon bearing all the time. We choose not to, though. So
Ryan,
it's not a one size fits all.
Would it be correct to say oil whip, oil whirl, and what were you just saying? When we have irregular patterns of how the shaft is moving.
Yeah, that's typically when we would go to a lemon bearing. If you have a higher speed application, like something above 4,000 RPM or something, we wouldn't use it then. We would go to something like a four lobe bearing or a pressure fed bearing to fix those same type of problems.
Yeah.
But in a self-contained bearing housing, we would go to a lemon bearing to fix that sort of oil whip, oil whirl.
Someone asked if it is possible for bearings to be within vibration limits and still make noise.
Sure.
That's been one of those hidden ghosts in the machine problems we've dealt with before. And those are tough to find, tough to nail down what the root cause is and things of that nature. But this goes back to that investigation thing where we may have to get FEA analysis involved, or maybe a deal where if there's no causes, no symptoms, no values to do anything, then you let it make noise.
Yeah, it could be fan noise. You know, it could be just noise from the pump itself. Okay. Pumps are noisy.
Are these bearing housing upgrades only applicable to API 610 pumps?
No. I mean, Landon, that's a question for you, not me.
Yeah, I mean, that's correct. We can put them on just about any pump, API or not. So as long as it can fit within the parameters, shaft and speed.
And so we've got specifications. We follow specifications. Ryan writes specifications. Even Landon writes specifications or fix some of Ryan's specifications as we go and find things. It's always going to be an ever-changing thing as we find a little bitty tweaks to make things better. Again, we're in the incremental changes ever since the advent of computers. But this stuff applies to anything that has a bearing on both sides of the impeller, you know. Then we go from that point to define what we can do.
How does oil mist play a role? Are there limits to applying oil mist on roller bearings?
Yeah, there are. Oil mist is generally, from a cooling standpoint, is considered a much better cooling arrangement for rolling element bearings. Just by its nature, you know, the entire bearing surface has a very thin mist of oil on it. I mean, that's kind of the sweet spot for how a rolling element bearing would prefer to operate. And then you're also circulating that oil through. So as the oil's heating up, you're removing it, and any oil that coalesces in the bottom of the housing, you're getting rid of that as well. There are limitations to it. They vary with size of the bearing, just like everything else. You know, you can't just because you're using oil mist, you can't spin a bearing to some super high speed with super high load. But the limits are, I would say, greater when you're using oil mist than when you're using some sort of splash lubrication.
Yeah, that's how I'd present it. There are always going to be limitations, but oil mist allows you to push a little further than you would with oil bath. Maybe, if it's all done right.
If you have a pump that is running beyond the BEP point, far right, will changing the bearing housing help to improve the bearing life?
Well, yeah, I think that goes back to that pre and post. If it's pre-1996, I bet it might. You know, it's really putting a Band-Aid on it, though. Your problem is you're not hydraulically aligned. When we deal with mechanical seals, by all means, we're usually fixing a symptom to get the mechanical seal to last longer than we are fixing a root cause. And sometimes that's the right answer. Sometimes fixing a root cause is way too expensive or way too involved.
And do you have any problems with the shaft movement with the ball sleeve hybrid bearing configuration if the energy density is over 5.4 M?
Not as a rule. Again, that goes back to a little bit of what I was alluding to with differences in small differences in hydraulic passageways from one casting to another. That's really what is driving a lot of the differences in radial load from one pump to a next to the next, and that's what's ultimately causing shaft movement. So that can happen, you know, even in a very low energy density pump, you can have a high radial load. It's much more likely in a high energy density, but you know, it's not limited to that.
So if you're having this issue in the field, and that's kind of maybe where this come from, you have this issue in the field and you're trying to decipher things, you know, looking back at what you're doing with relation to the engineering practices only provides like an overall insight, which we do a lot. We always kind of look back and say, okay, from a operational standpoint, where are you operating this pump on the curve? And is the, you know, MPSH correct? You know, all those engineering requirements. I think this follows the same path as, you know, if you're having this problem in the field, you're going to go look at those things and say, okay, well, this is clearly high here. And maybe that's the only thing. Maybe that's the one thing. It's above that 5.4 number. If that's the only thing you're seeing that's abnormal to engineering calculations, then it goes back to what Ryan said. Maybe, maybe not. You just got to investigate further. And that's what we're here to do. That's Doug Story, myself. That's what we do is come investigate that and help you.
Yeah, the instrumentation will too, like I alluded to, will go a long way to tell you, you know, is it sure. Really a shaft movement problem that you're having? Is it a vibration problem that you're having? Or, you know, what is the real problem?
Okay. Why are pipeline pumps treated differently from other pumps? And can they use hybrid combinations?
So one thing, I don't know that maybe we didn't specifically say, is, you know, API 610 is a set of guidelines. You know, it's not hard and fast rules. You know, these aren't laws that we have to follow or else we get punished, you know. So pipeline, I think, is treated differently because pipeline customers, you know, choose to allow different exceptions than, say, in the building refinery type customers, you know. So that's, I would say, number one is why it's treated differently, because the industry that we're serving allows it to be.
Capitalism. this is why capitalism, because yeah. This is a competitive industry. It's competitive to sell a new pump. It's so if you're going to go out there and follow API's original guidelines and you're going to throw out a lube oil system with a tilt pad, thrust bearing and sleeve radial bearings, it's expensive. It's a lot more of components to maintain, and you're going to compete against a guy that's not. So the reason it's changed is because companies like, you know, Sulzer has come back and said, we got plenty. I don't know if thousands are the right word, but there's plenty of applications out there for decades of proof that it's okay to push beyond that 5.4 number, among other things that we push. And it's just because we have to be competitive.
We'll just do a couple of more questions because we are at our time here. Just two more. Are four lobe bearings standard for Sulzer?
No, we do have four lobe bearing options though, and we typically use them in higher speed type applications like beyond 3600 RPM.
And then we'll do just one more last question. How do you determine which bearing housings need coolers and which ones don't? What factors are involved in that decision?
So it's all temperature based. It's, you know, two primary inputs are what's your process fluid temp and what's your ambient temp. And those are the big primary drivers to it. And then along with that, you have size of the bearing. So that'll also kind of determine how much internal heat we're generating. So those three things, but the two primary drivers are process temp and ambient temp.
And Barry in the lead, Ryan. You know why we know how we determine? Ryan. Ryan hacks how we determine it. He does R&D and he sits there and pushes these bearings to their limits and says, okay, we can get great all the way to this limit with this specific bearing design and how it's set up. And so that's how we create specifications and then defining where those limits are. And it's all, like you said, based on temperature, but that's how we determine them. That's how we come to the conclusion in the first place. Smart guys like you, buddy.
Sounds great. Well, that should take care of our presentation today. I want to also thank Sulzer and all of our presenters again for being here with us and for the attendees for tuning in today. And again, if you we did not get to your question, please feel free to email Doug or Seth at their email addresses there. Sorry, did you want to say one more thing? Okay. Great. Well, thank you again very much. And we hope that everyone has a wonderful day. Thanks for the presentation, everyone.
Yes. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.